Hello students, welcome to the biology online class life processes part 7. Today we are going to learn about transportation, which is one of the important life processes. In the previous videos we have learned about life processes like nutrition and respiration, and today we are going to know about one more important life processes, that is transportation. First of all, we have to know what is meant by transportation. Transportation, in another way, it is also called circulation. Transportation is also called circulation. And then what is meant by circulation? It is nothing but the process of movement of oxygen, carbon dioxide, water, waste substances and secretions of glands. Secretions of glands means nothing but hormones from one region to the another region. It is called transportation. In a simple way, we can tell that transportation is also called translocation of materials. Translocation. Translocation means changing the place. What we have learned during nutrition, what happened there? The digested food absorbed into the blood, and through the blood, it reaches to each and every cell of the body. Is it right? Like that in the respiration process also, whatever oxygen we inhale, that one reaches to all cells of the body. How can they reach to all cells of the body without any separate system inside our body? That separate system which helps to transport all these materials from one place to the another place is called transportation or circulatory system. Transportation is also called circulatory system. And if you observe in human beings, this transportation system, that means circulatory system, involves three important parts. First one, blood. Second one, blood vessels. And third one, heart. Because of all these important parts, the circulatory system in human beings is also called cardiovascular system. The circulatory system is also called cardiovascular system. And now we will learn about each and every important part of the circulatory system briefly. First of all, first important component of the circulatory system is blood. You all know that. What is the color of the blood? It is in red color. Why? Blood is in red color due to the presence of a red pigment which is called hemoglobin. Is it right? And then blood is also called fluid connective tissue. Fluid connective tissue. Why it is also called fluid connective tissue? Blood is the material which is in liquid state, that's why it is called fluid, and it connects all parts of the body, that's why it is called connective. And tissue means a group of cells. You all know that tissue means group of cells. Blood means nothing but cells only. Millions of cells are present in blood. That's why a group of cells is called tissue. So blood is also called fluid connective tissue, which connects every part of the body. And if you see, in an adult human being, nearly 6.8 liters of blood is present. 6.8 liters of blood is present in an adult human being. And it is somewhat in alkaline nature. The pH value is 7.4. The blood is in red color due to the presence of hemoglobin. And again, if you observe, the blood contains three important components. There are three important components present in blood. First of all, if you see, the first important component of the blood is plasma. Second component is blood corpuscles. Corpuscles means nothing but cells only, blood cells. And third important component is blood platelets. How many components are there in the blood? Three components are present. First one, plasma. Second one, blood corpuscles. And third one, blood platelets. Now let us know about each and every component present in the blood. Don't forget, don't confuse that. Circulatory system includes three important parts. First one, blood. Second one, blood vessels. Third one, heart. Again, in the blood, there are three important components. First one, plasma. Second one, blood corpuscles. that means blood cells, and third one blood platelets. Now we are going to learn about each and every component of the blood. First of all, plasma. What is plasma? Plasma is the liquid part of a blood. You all know that blood is in liquid state. How does it get its liquid state? Due to the presence of plasma only. And if you know more about this plasma, it is somewhat in pale straw colored. Pale straw color means light yellowish in color, and it is non-living, and it is the fluid part of the blood. Plasma is in yellowish in color, it is non-living, and it is the fluid part of the blood. And if you see, it is formed of 90 to 92% of water and 7 to 8% of proteins and other organic compounds like glucose, amino acids, vitamins, urea, uric acid, hormones and antibodies, etc. This plasma contains all these nutrients. And what is the function of this plasma? It gives liquid portion to the blood, that is right, and along with that it also helps in the temperature regulation of the body, which is called homeothermy. Plasma involves in the process temperature regulation, which is also called homeothermy. And it also includes in the another function, that is called providing immunity. It provides immunity. What is meant by immunity? Immunity means disease resistant power. It also provides disease resistant power to the body. I hope you have understood what is plasma and what is the function of this plasma and what are the components present in the plasma. Now let us know about the second important component of the blood, that is nothing but blood corpuscles. Blood contains two types of cells. One is RBC, second one is WBC. RBC means red blood corpuscles, WBC means white blood corpuscles. How many types of cells are present in the blood? There are two types. They are RBC and WBC. And let us know about each and every corpuscle here. First of all, look at this RBC. If you see the shape of the RBC, the blood cells, the red blood cells are in circular in shape and most of the cells are in biconcave in nature. Every cell of the body contains nucleus. You all know that. Every cell of the body, in the center of the cell, there is a round body structure which is called nucleus. But in the case of red blood cells, nucleus is absent. That's why it is called denucleated. RBC is denucleated. And if you see the number of RBC, these are more in number when compared to the WBC. Nearly 5 to 5 million of RBC are present in 1 cubic meter of blood. This is called blood count. 5 to 5.5 million of RBC are present in the blood. And if you see the size of the RBC, it is nearly 7.5 microns. And this RBC contains hemoglobin, which is the red pigment which gives red color to the blood. That's why only we can call these blood corpuscles red blood corpuscles. Hemoglobin is present, which is also called respiratory pigment. We all know that through the blood only, whatever oxygen we inhale, that is transported to all cells of the body. Through the blood means in the blood, in the RBC, hemoglobin is present, which is called respiratory pigment. Whatever oxygen we inhale, that one diffuses into the blood and it sticks on to the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin pigment. Then only it transports to each and every cell of the body. After diffusion of the oxygen molecule into the hemoglobin, then this hemoglobin molecule is called oxyhemoglobin. Oxyhemoglobin. In the condition of oxyhemoglobin only, oxygen reaches to each and every cell of the body. And again, what is the function of this RBC? Just now I told you, transportation of oxygen, and it also transports carbon dioxide from the cells to the respiratory organs to send out. I hope you have understood the structure and function of the RBC. Now let us know about WBC. WBC means white blood cells. If you see the shape of the WBC, most of the WBC are in amoeboid in nature. What is amoeboid nature? Amoeboid in shape means amoeba, it is one unicellular organism which does not contain any proper shape. Here also WBC, they can change their shape accordingly. And some of the WBC are present in circular in shape. And if you see the nucleus, WBC are nucleated. Nucleus is present. And when compared to the RBC, WBC is present lesser in number. That means nearly 5000 to 10,000 only. What I told you here under RBC, those are present, 5 to 5.5 millions of RBC are present in the blood. But in the case of WBC, if you see, only 5000 to 10,000 WBC are present per 1 cubic meter of blood. Or if you see the size of the WBC, these are somewhat larger than the RBC, 5 to 15 microns in size. Here RBC only 7.5 microns, WBC in between 5 to 15 microns in size. Hemoglobin is absent, that's why there is no red color to this type of blood cells. That's why only we are calling this type of blood cells white blood cells. And what is the function of these white blood cells in the blood? They act as soldiers and eat upon the germs. They protect our body from the diseases. Or if you see, next one more important point under RBC, the lifespan of the RBC, is nearly 115 to 120 days. Within this 120 days, many of the RBC may destroy in liver and in the spleen. And again, new RBC are produced in the bone marrow of long bones. And if you see the lifespan of the RBC, WBC, maximum 14 days of, within 14 days, they may destroy. I hope you have understood the second component of the blood, which is nothing but blood corpuscles. Now we will learn third component. That is nothing but platelets, blood platelets. These blood platelets are very smallest cells present in the blood. And function, if you see, these platelets are very helpful in blood clotting. Whenever we get an injury, these platelets release an enzyme which is called thromboplastin, and this thromboplastin causes coagulation of blood. Coagulation means clotting of blood, and because of this coagulation, it prevents excessive bleeding. Platelets are very important whenever we get any injury to stop the excess bleeding. These are the three important components present in the blood. Now let us see the second important part of the circulatory system, which is nothing but blood vessels. There are three types of blood vessels present in the circulatory system. First is arteries, second one is veins, third one capillaries. Let us see each and everything very briefly. Arteries means these are the blood vessels which carries oxygenated blood away from the heart. If you see the structure of these arteries, arteries are somewhat in thick nature, more elastic and deep seated in our body. Those are present very deeply inside the muscles. And it carries pure blood. Pure blood means the blood which contains oxygen. It is also called oxygenated blood. And here if you see, arteries carries this pure blood away from the heart always. That means it carries pure blood to all parts of the body. Away from the heart means nothing but it carries pure blood, that means oxygenated blood, to all parts of the body. The structure is, those are thick, more elastic, deep seated, and it carries oxygenated blood, and it carries the blood away from the heart to all parts of the body. This is about arteries, one of the blood vessels. And if you see the second blood vessels, veins. Veins are thin when compared to arteries and less elastic in nature. Those are present superficial, that means they just lie below the skin. We can able to observe these veins. If you observe carefully at our joints, we can see these blood vessels which are in greenish in color. And what is the function of these veins? It carries, these blood vessels carries impure blood. Impure blood means the blood which contains carbon dioxide. And it carries this impure blood towards the heart. That means, in another words, we can tell that it carries impure blood from all parts of the body to the heart for purification. This is about veins. And let us see this third type of blood vessels, capillaries. Capillaries are very thinnest blood vessels which are present inside our body, and after reaching arteries to every cell of the body, they divide and redivide, they form into capillaries, very thinnest and finest blood vessels, and open into all organs of the body, and it also connects arteries and veins. Capillaries are also connect arteries and veins. I hope you have understood the second important part of the circulatory system, which is nothing but blood vessels. There are three types of blood vessels: arteries, which carry pure blood; veins, which carry impure blood; capillaries, where there is exchange of gases takes place, exchange of materials takes place. Now let us see the third important component of the circulatory system. Let us know about very important organ of the circulatory system, which is nothing but heart. It is pumping organ. It always pumps the blood to all parts of the body, and also it receives blood from all parts of the body. If you see the structure of the heart, it is one thick muscular organ which is about fist size, and which is in reddish in brown color, and it is somewhat in conical in shape. And where it is present? You all know that heart is present in our thoracic cavity. That means in our chest region. And in between the two lungs, heart is present. If you see here, the heart is tilted towards left side in the thoracic cavity. It present in between the two lungs and tilted towards the left side. And it is in our fist size. It is in reddish in brown color. If you see the shape of the heart, it is in conical shape. It is one thick muscular organ. And if you see, the heart is protected by very fine layer which is called pericardium. See this sixth point. Pericardium means the layers which have protected the heart. Heart is surrounded by two layers which are called pericardium. And if you observe the internal structure of the heart, heart contains four chambers. Inside the heart, it contains four chambers. The upper two chambers are called auricles or atria. Auricles are also called atria. The lower two chambers are called ventricles. The upper two chambers are somewhat smaller than in size when compared to the lower parts of the lower chambers of the heart. What do we call the upper two chambers? Those are called auricles. Auricles are also called atria. Atria means plural. Atrium is the singular form of that word. And the down two chambers are called ventricles. When compared to the auricles, the walls of the ventricles are somewhat very thick, because the function of the ventricle is pumping the blood to all parts of the body. Because of this, ventricles are made up of thick muscle. See here, the size of the heart, it fits on our left hand fist. This is real heart. The size of the heart is fist size. Left hand fist size. And see this. In human beings, heart contains four chambers. Like that, in other organisms, if you observe, fish contains only two chambers in their heart. This is fish heart, and this right side heart is frog heart. Frog means one amphibian which lives both on the land and in water. It contains only three chambers. Human beings' heart contains four chambers. Fish heart contains only two chambers, one auricle, one ventricle, And if you see the amphibian heart, it contains three chambers. The upper two are called auricles, lower only one ventricle is present. See here, the amphibian heart internally only two upper auricles are present. Lower, there is no partition between ventricles. There is no wall present between the ventricles. And again, if you see the reptile's heart, reptiles means the organisms which can crawl. Here in this case of reptiles, partially divided four chambers heart is present in the reptile case. That means two auricles are separated with a septum, and the lower two chambers, that means ventricles, are partially divided with a wall-like structure which is called septum. That means partially divided four-chambered heart is present in reptile heart. See here the heart anatomy from fish to animals. Fish only two chambers, amphibian three chambers heart, reptile partially divided four-chambered heart, but except in the case of crocodile. Crocodile contains fully divided four-chambered heart. Crocodile is also a reptile, but all reptiles contain partially divided four chambers heart except crocodile. Or if you see birds, birds contain completely divided four chambered heart just like mammals. That means mammals included all other organisms including human beings also. This is about heart anatomy. Anatomy means internal structure. Again, if you learn about the four chambers of the heart, the upper two chambers are called auricles, the lower two chambers are called ventricles. And what are the differences between these two, auricles and ventricles? If you see the auricles first, the upper two chambers are called auricles. Those are thin-walled when compared to the lower two chambers. And the wall of the auricles is somewhat smooth in nature. And these chambers are also called receiving chambers. Always they receive blood from different parts of the body or from the lungs. That's why auricles are called receiving chambers. And if you see the second important chamber, that means lower chambers are called ventricles. The structure of the ventricle, those are lower chambers, thick walled chambers. They have ridges on their walls. That means here and there some fissures are there. Those are not smooth in nature. They have ridges on their wall nature, and those are called distributing chambers. Always they distribute the blood to all parts of the body, along with that to the lungs. I hope you have understood the differences between auricles and ventricles. What are these auricles and ventricles? These are the chambers present inside the heart. The upper two chambers are called auricles, which are also called receiving chambers, and the lower two chambers are called ventricles. These are also called distributing chambers. I hope you have understood the basic part of the circulatory system and the components of the circulatory system in this video. Hari Bol.